Hello everyone. Today I'm going to share with you probably one of the simplest ways to take control of your health. I'm talking about reading food labels accurately. In the over 15 years of teaching this particular topic, I have noticed that even the people that thought they knew what to look for in food labels actually didn't. It's important to recognize where to find information that food manufacturers disguise by using vocabulary the majority of consumers may not understand. This is all in an attempt to sell their product and pass it for healthier than it really is. I truly believe that the content of this video can impact your health positively. So I hope you stick around. Let's get to it. We're going to see the most important nutrients in a food label, how to compare similar foods and pick the healthiest options, and tricks to watch out for that manufacturers use to make their food look healthier than it is. If you enjoy this type of information and want weekly updates, don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel, Simply Health. Food labels are standardized, which is very helpful because once you learn how to read one, you can read any. In general, labels have two parts, a nutrition facts panel and an ingredients list. They are both equally important. Let's start with the information found in the nutritional fact panel. A good starting place is looking at calories per serving. It's hard to miss. They are right here in large bold numbers. It's important to know that all the information in the nutrition facts panels applies to one serving only. So after you know how many calories there are in one serving, you want to review how many servings your container has, which is right here. What this tells me is that, for example, in this food, it's a box of cereal, there are 140 calories in one serving. Also, this tells me that one serving is equivalent to one cup. So if I wanted to be accurate, I would actually have to measure one cup. It also tells me that there are 9 servings in the entire box of cereal. So if I scoop 2 cups of cereal into a bowl, I will be consuming 280 calories. Most of us may also add milk and some may also add table sugar. So you'd have to include the additional calories. Here's a second example. Let's look at this label from a bag of chips. There are 160 calories in one serving and there are 7 servings in the bag. This means that if you eat half of the bag, you're eating 3.5 servings. And 3.5 servings times 160 calories per serving is 560 calories, which is a lot of calories and not that hard to do if you're hungry and too tired to cook. After we're done with the calories, we go down the list. Depending on your situation, you may want to focus on one nutrient versus another. In my case, I read and review food labels with the intent of preventing disease, especially high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, and heart disease. Bear with me while I explain the daily values found right here in this column. All percent daily values are based on a 2000 calorie diet. This is standard. And although it's unlikely that most people will be eating exactly 2000 calories a day, it's still a helpful tool to get a rough idea of how much of a nutrient a food contains and to compare with similar food items. When looking at the percent daily values, here's a useful tip. It's called the 520 rule. The 520 rule simply means that if a food has less than 5% the daily value of that nutrient, then it's considered low for that nutrient. If a food contains 20% or more daily value, then that's considered high for that nutrient. I always look at the total fat content, as well as saturated fats and trans fats. Since I want to lower my chances of developing heart disease, I will look for daily values of these fats that is less than 5%. Trans fats should be non-existent, but beware. Even when you see 0 trans fats right here in this section, it doesn't mean this is true. And I will explain this manufacturer trick in a minute. Continue down the list by looking at the amount of cholesterol and be as close to 5% daily value as possible to ensure heart health. We've arrived to sodium. The sodium percent daily value can be misleading. Sodium is an essential nutrient and we need it to survive, but too much sodium on a regular basis leads to high blood pressure, which can lead to strokes and heart disease. The percent daily value of sodium is based on 2300 milligrams a day, which is way above the daily recommended intake amount. The American Heart Association recommends 1500 milligrams of sodium a day for adults 18 years or over, and 1200 milligrams a day if you're over 70 years old. This percent daily value is based in 2300 milligrams, and it's way too much for most people. So at the very least, you can use the 520 rule and do not go over 20% daily value of sodium. Also remember that these numbers that you see are only for one serving. For total carbohydrates, what I focus on is how much fiber the food contains and how much added sugars. If possible, avoid foods that have added sugars altogether, or at least be close to that 5% daily value. This will help you decrease the risk of diabetes. Another nutrient that helps you prevent and control diabetes is the carbohydrate fiber. So be sure that the percent daily value of fiber is 20 or above. If I'm focusing on wanting to eat more or less protein, I can find its information here. I have yet to find a person deficient in protein in the United States unless they have a debilitating illness. The majority of people eat more protein than what they need, which is a topic for a different video. Lastly, for the vitamins and minerals section, I pay attention to calcium and iron, and I use the same 520 rule that I've explained earlier. I want to show you another useful technique when it comes to using the daily values. Let's say that after a blood test, you find out that you have a mild deficiency of iron. Mild deficiencies can be treated with food and they don't require supplementation, but it does require that you pay closer attention to what you are eating. So let's say I'm mildly deficient in iron. I will want to focus on my iron intake and look for foods that have at least 20% daily value of iron. I also use the percent daily values to compare similar foods, like two boxes of cereal or two loaves of bread. When doing this, first, I make sure that I'm comparing the same serving sizes. And then in this case, if I was mildly iron deficient, I would look for which cereal has the most iron. So that is a really helpful tool that I use the daily values for all the time. Now, let's look at the ingredients list, the second part of food labels. By law, most packaged foods must list the ingredients in descending order of predominance by weight. A quick peek at the very first ingredients in a food label can tell you a lot about how healthy this food is. Let's see what we need to focus on when we're looking at the ingredients list. First, if the ingredients list for a simple food like yogurt, peanut butter, or potato chips is longer than two or three ingredients, then I question why there are more ingredients than necessary and how natural that food really is. Second, if I do not know what an ingredient is, or I can't spell it or even pronounce it, I wonder what I'm eating, so I leave that food and buy an alternative. Third, if I see fully hydrogenated or partially hydrogenated oils in this portion, I leave the food on the shelf and look for an alternative. These types of oils are artificially made and terrible for your heart, brain, arteries, and overall well-being. While on this topic, always look for partially hydrogenated oils in the ingredients list. Because even if the Nutrition Facts panel says that there are 0 grams of trans fats in one serving, that's not necessarily true, as each serving of a food could contain 0.4 grams of trans fats per serving, and by law, still say that there are 0 trans fats. So the only way to be absolutely sure that you're not eating any trans fats is to look at the list of ingredients and avoid these partially hydrogenated oils. Fourth, if I see mono or diglycerides in the ingredients list, I also leave that food and look for an alternative. This is a way that manufacturers hide fats. These are fats that do not have to be recorded in the Nutrition Facts panel. So it may look like you're eating a low-fat food, but you aren't if you're eating mono or diglycerides. So this is another way that manufacturers can hide trans fats, saturated fats, and fats altogether from us. Fifth, corn ingredients. You probably have heard of high fructose corn syrup. I avoid this ingredient all the time. If you want to know why it's smart to avoid this ingredient, let me know in the comments below. Also be aware, after heavy lobbying of the Corn Refiners Association, manufacturers can label high fructose corn syrup as corn syrup or fructose syrup. And a manufacturer may even claim no high fructose corn syrup on the box. Really, all they are doing is hiding high fructose corn syrup under the label of corn syrup or fructose syrup. So the only way to really know if you're eating high fructose corn syrup is by going into the ingredients list, avoiding anything that says corn syrup, fructose syrup, or high fructose corn syrup. I hope that these facts were helpful. Remember to press the like button and subscribe to receive weekly health news. Until next time, cheers to your health.